In this video, we're looking at a surface of revolution formed by revolving the graph of sine x on 0 to pi about the x-axis. Once we set it up, the resulting integral turns out to be really interesting. It requires multiple substitutions and, as you can see in the hints, it requires the formula for the integral of secant cubed as well. I'm going to leave the proof of the secant cubed formula to another video because this one is already long enough. So you can see in the picture, I've already drawn an increment of area into the surface. And that's a thin ribbon with a width given by a small increment of arc called ds. And the ribbon is located at a position of x, which means the radius of this thing is given by the height of the function corresponding to x. In other words, the radius is sine x. Next, we cut and unroll this ribbon, and that looks something like this. And there's my width, ds. And then the length of this very skinny rectangle is going to correspond to the circumference of the ribbon when it was rolled up. So that's 2 pi times the radius, or 2 pi sine x. Then we'll refer to this small increment of area as an area contribution, dA. So here's where we're at. We have dA is equal to 2 pi sine x ds. Here's where we have to be reminded how to write down the arc length increment, ds. And I'll post a link to the video where I derive this. So ds is given by the square root of 1 plus the derivative of the curve squared, and the derivative of sine x is cosine x. So there's my arc length ds. Now I can plug this back into the formula for dA, and I've got 2 pi sine x times the square root of 1 plus cosine squared x. Since everything is phrased in terms of x now, we're ready to set this up as an integral. We say that the total surface area is the sum of all the contributions. That's what an integral does. It just adds up these continuously changing infinitesimal contributions. And I phrased it entirely in terms of x now, so I can put in my x limits of integration. That's 0 to pi. 2 pi sine x, square root 1 plus cosine squared x, dx. Now we get into this non-trivial integral. So when you look at 1 plus cosine squared, you might be tempted to say there must be some identity that's going to help me out of this jam. And it just doesn't work that way. There's no identity for 1 plus cosine squared x that's going to give you anything useful. But what I do notice here is that the derivative of cosine is sitting in this integrand. The derivative of cosine is negative sine. So all I have to do is throw a minus sign in there, and I've got the derivative of cosine. So this looks like a u substitution to me. I can replace cosine with u, and then the derivative of u is going to be basically the sine function, and I should be able to transform the integral. So here's my first substitution. Let u equal cosine x. Then du is negative sine x dx. I'm also going to transform the limits of integration so I don't have to go back and express my answer in terms of x at the end of the problem. So when x is equal to 0, I look at my substitution here to figure this out. U is going to be cosine 0, which is 1. And when x is equal to pi, u is going to be cosine pi, which is negative 1. So because I'm tight on space here, I'm going to go ahead and manipulate this integral in the previous line. I need to multiply by negative 1 to find negative sine x in this interior. So I'm just going to jam it in here. Negative. That means I need to multiply the outside of the integral by negative 1 as well. So I put that outside. And now this negative sine x dx can be replaced with du. And the square root part can be replaced with 1 plus u squared. Again, my new limits of integration are 1 to negative 1. This 2 pi is a spectator. I'll take care of that in a second. There's a couple things I can do to clean this up before I get into how to find the integral of a square root of 1 plus u squared. First, I have a minus sign out in front. And if I take the negative of an integral, it reverses the limits of integration. And I'm just a little uneasy having this sort of backwards integral going from 1 to negative 1. So let's just take care of that real quick. And I'm also going to move the 2 pi out in front. So I reverse my limits of integration to something that looks a little more ordinary. Then I notice that I'm dealing with an even function in the integrand. 1 plus u squared, if I replace u with negative u, I just get back the original function. That means it has even symmetry. And given this interval symmetric about the origin, I can just say that I get twice. So I'm going to move a factor of 2 out in front and make that a 4 pi. I get twice the integral of just the right half of this thing from 0 to 1. And it's going to turn out that having that 0 as one of my limits of integration actually saves us a lot of work in this problem. All right, next step. I have a square root of 1 plus u squared. This is a classic trig substitution integral. I need to think of an identity that involves 1 plus something squared. And in this case, it's the tangent function. 1 plus tangent squared gives me secant squared. So I'm going to replace u with tangent theta. That means du is secant squared theta d theta. Again, I'm going to transform the limits of integration. So when u is 0, I look up here at my substitution. When u is 0, I have tangent theta equals 0. Well, that happens at theta equals 0. And when u is 1, I have 1 equals tangent theta. That happens at theta equals pi over 4. So I modify my integral again, and I have 4 pi integral from 0 to pi over 4, square root 1 plus tangent squared theta, and then du is secant squared theta d theta. And 1 plus tangent squared is secant squared, but when I square root that, I just get another copy of the secant function, and now I can see how I end up with a secant cubed integral. Again, that integral itself is very non-trivial. It requires multiple applications of integration by parts. It's a really interesting integral in its own right. Here, we're just going to quote the formula for secant cubed. So I get 1 half secant x tangent x plus a 1 half natural log of the absolute value of secant x plus tangent x. And I'm evaluating this from 0 to pi over 4. First off, I can pull the 1 half out of this thing. So I end up with a 2 pi out in front. Then when I look at my lower limit, I'm plugging in 0 for x. And in this first expression, that would give me a tangent of 0, which is 0. So that vanishes. In my second expression, again, the tangent would come out to 0, so that's gone. And the secant of 0 is 1 over the cosine of 0, which gives me 1. And the natural log of 1 is 0, so that vanishes. All that's left is what we get from the upper limit. So it really paid off to recognize that even symmetry. It gave us a really useful 0 in this case. All right, I've already pulled out the 1 half, and I'm going to plug in pi over 4 here. I get secant pi over 4, tangent pi over 4. Plus the natural log absolute value secant pi over 4 plus tangent pi over 4. Secant, again, is 1 over cosine. And the cosine of pi over 4 can be written as 1 over root 2. So 1 over 1 over root 2. And then the tangent of pi over 4 is just 1. In my natural log piece, I have the natural log of the absolute value. Well, both of these are going to give me positive numbers, so I'm not worried about the absolute value signs. And again, secant pi over 4 is root 2. Tangent pi over 4 is 1. So there's our exact area for the surface of revolution using the sine function. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.